Belinda and Gil Books presents this unabridged recording of
Wildwoods, The Magic of Ireland's Native Woodlands, written by Richard Nairn and read by Ruairi Conaghan. For my grandchildren, Ivy, Iris and Robin. Richard Nairn is an ecologist and writer who has spent a lifetime studying nature. He is an advocate of nature conservation and lectures regularly. During his career, he has worked as the Nature Reserve Warden and was the first director of Birdwatch Ireland. He is a scientific advisor to Woodlands of Ireland and the author of numerous books. Also by Richard Nairn. Wild Wicklow, Natures in the Garden of Ireland. Ireland's Coastline, Exploring Its Nature and Heritage. Bird Habitats in Ireland, joint editor. Dublin Bay, Nature and History. Preface. The final parts of this book were written in 2020 during the coronavirus pandemic that swept across the world, stopping a lot of normal human activity in its tracks. My usual work was suspended. Travel was restricted to local journeys only, and I found myself largely confined to my home place. But nature continued pretty much as usual. Primroses flowered in spring, hazel catkins glowed yellow at dawn, the first swallows appeared on the same date as the previous year, and the sun shone each day of that early summer. The familiarity of nature's seasons was more than reassuring. My daily routine slowed, and every day seemed to be the same. I left my mobile phone at home and spent much more time that year alone in our woodland, planting trees, chopping logs, and just observing nature around me. I cooked meals on an open wood fire, and I sat for hours by the river, listening to birdsong and the rustling of the leaves. The wood gave me the sanctuary that I needed as the world outside was consumed by a deadly illness. I learnt the true value of nature to the human soul. The book has benefited from information, photographs and guidance generously provided by
Michael Carey,
Mike Carswell, John Cross, Joanne Denyer, Paul Dowding, Catherine Duff, Shirley Gleason, Amber Godwin, Joe Gowron, Kira Hamilton, Claire Herdman, Matthew Jebb, Colin Kelleher, Daniel Kelly, Mary Kelly Quinn, Ian Killeen, Declan Little, Colin McLaughlin, Evelyn Merkins, Declan Murphy, Derry Nairn, Tim Nairn, Will O'Connor, Christian Osthoff, Carl Partridge, Paddy Purser, Jenny Roche, Tim Roderick, Mark Ruddock, Liz Shepherd, Ralph Shepherd, Courtney Tyler, Angus Tyner, and Paddy Woodworth. Members of Woodlands of Ireland have provided much stimulation and discussion about all aspects of native woodlands that prompted many of the ideas in this book. I would like to acknowledge Blood Axe Books for permission to reproduce the poem When the Tree Falls by Jane Clark. I also acknowledge Faber and Faber for permission to reproduce an extract from Blackberry Picking by Seamus Heaney. My thanks are due to Margaret Connolly. Her excellent local history of a neighbouring townland called Achoil gave me the factual context for describing the lives of previous owners of our land, who themselves are fictitious, with no connection to any living person. Quilter Nature is acknowledged for supporting the publication of this book, which I hope will be helpful in their valuable work. Declan Little read the entire manuscript and made many useful suggestions for its improvement. The editor, Sheila Armstrong, kept the whole project on track and helped me turn the science into readable form. Last but not least, I am thankful for the support of my wife, Wendy, and our family in the exciting project we have taken on together to manage our land in a more sustainable way into the future. Introduction. It's early morning, and I set off with my dog Molly to walk to a woodland that is just 5 minutes from our house. On the way, we walk beneath a line of centuries-old oak trees that must have witnessed some interesting people passing by over the years on this quiet road to the village. This land on all sides was once part of a large estate known as Glanmore, acquired in stages by one Francis Singh in the early 19th century. This was just a few years after the upheavals of the 1798 rebellion, and local people were still coming to terms with some horrific deaths in their own country. Some survivors were forced to take refuge in the local woods. The tenants here were pleased that their new landlord was living locally in a big house at the edge of the Devil's Glen Wood. Up to then, their rents had been paid to a land agent who worked for an absentee landlord. To plan the expansion of his estate, Singh commissioned an extensive survey of the lands in this valley. In the 8 years after 1816, he supervised the planting of over 160,000 trees on his newly acquired lands. I suspect that these included the oak trees that still line the road today. By 1840, there was also a group of small cottages, probably with thatched roofs, along the road between the young oak trees. Ned Burns' father had inherited the lease of 20 acres of good land here, including a small woodland in the bottom of the valley. The laneway, which led down to the river in the wood, was used by all the occupants of the cottages to collect water for the houses and firewood for the hearths. In a corner of a field, I found a heap of large stones, all that remains of the cottage that had been built by Ned's grandfather. It was in this cottage that Ned was born. This was a time of serious difficulty for the Glanmore estate. Francis Singh had died in 1831, and his son John Singh took over the running of the estate. But his tenants became increasingly impoverished, and most lived on a diet dominated by potatoes. Some were evicted when they could not pay the rents. Meanwhile, the new landlord was spending money that he did not have to create a grand domain and maintain his standing in society. He ignored the fact that the estate was falling deeper and deeper into debt. When he died in 1845, the very year that the Great Famine began, the estate was bankrupt and his son, called Francis Singh after his grandfather, was faced with court proceedings to sell the land and pay the debtors. But he managed, after several years, to buy back the estate house and some other properties. Francis Singh was popular in the locality as he was said to be a hard-working farmer and looked after his tenants. Ned was just a small child when the potato famine hit the area in 1846, but he could remember some of his neighbours being evicted and living in animal sheds through the winter. As a small child, he saw poor families make their last journey along the road beneath the growing oak trees. In the following years, many local people emigrated or tried to rebuild their lives. But Ned's parents were determined to stay and make the best of the situation, so he grew up working on his father's farm. In time, this would be Ned's farm, and he loved the place. The work made him healthy and strong, just like the oak trees along the road, whose canopies now gave passers-by some welcome shade from the summer sun. As I walk along the same road, I search the ground beneath the trees for any new acorns that have fallen from the oak trees in the night, or stare up into the vast tumble of branches and twigs, never failing to marvel at the sheer size and strength of these gentle giants. A cool wind blows down the valley from the mountain, sweeping across the fields and bending the branches of the trees. I watch the old hedge across the top field for a fox that I know lives just beyond it, and for the rabbits that help her to survive through the year. Climbing the stile, I drop down the golden, bracken-covered slope and enter the shelter of the trees. A familiar hawthorn covered with red berries greets me as I pass beneath the mature ash and alder trees. I stand for a minute on the path to listen to the trickling water that flows down the hill from the line of groundwater springs. The air is cool and still on my face. A woodpecker's distinctive pick-pick call and the ticking of a robin are the only evidence of birds in the dawn. I walk over to my favourite tree, the biggest birch in the wood, and sit beneath it for a few minutes to absorb its wisdom and strength. The trunk is strengthened by splayed buttress roots, just like the supports of a cathedral wall. High above, the branches spread wide with their spiral structure, adding strength to the timber. This tree, which Ned probably climbed as a child, is now quite rotten in the centre. I can put my entire arm into a large cavity which once held the heartwood, but the outer layers, or sapwood, of the tree are as vigorous as the day it was a young sapling in a new woodland. For years, my own family had been searching for some land to establish a small holding where we could grow our own food and cut wood for fuel, moving our lives more towards self-sufficiency with a lower environmental footprint. We had searched far and wide, and when Ned's farm was finally put on the market, we knew that it was again offering an opportunity, On the south-facing side of the valley were the permanent pasture fields and hedge groves, where he had toiled all those years ago. I imagined him in summer driving the horse-drawn mower through the flower-rich meadow to save the hay that would sustain his cows over winter. The woodland, where he and his sons had cut timber to roof the cow byre, was still there in the valley, and the river that wound its way down from the hill still flowed crystal clear. Throwing caution to the wind, I cashed in part of my pension and bought the land outright. Even if times turned harder, I foolishly reckoned that I could sell the land and the timber to recover my investment. Instead, I fell in love with the place and began to spend more and more time there, experiencing all its moods and seasons, discovering its wildlife secrets and learning how to manage it properly. I realise now that our woodland has found its way into my heart. For most of my adult life, I have worked to protect the environment. As a nature reserve warden, as director of a voluntary conservation body, and more recently, advising organisations, large and small, how to avoid or reduce damage to nature. Yet, during my lifetime, Ireland's wildlife has undergone a catastrophic decline. A third of all species groups examined in Ireland, including plants, birds, butterflies, freshwater fish and dragonflies, are either threatened with extinction or near threatened. Birds that were once commonplace in the Irish countryside, the curlew, corncrake and yellowhammer, have become so rare that it is a privilege to see even one. Water quality in our rivers and lakes has declined steadily, so that now there are only a handful of pristine inland waters. 90% of our highest value habitats, listed under the EU's Habitats Directive, are in poor or inadequate condition. Ireland still has the lowest forest cover of any country in the European Union, and little over 1% of the country is occupied by native woodland. After years of writing, protesting and trying to influence nature policy, I could see no change in this depressing trend, and I worried for the future of our natural world. I needed to be inspired again, and I knew that nature could provide this inspiration if I could just see some positive results for my efforts. In this land, I found a project, no matter how small, where I could make a real contribution to restoring the natural environment. The baton had been passed from Ned's family to me to protect this heritage for the coming generations, including my children and grandchildren. Everyone has something to offer, even if it is just planting a few trees or saving a hedgerow from destruction. This land had also stirred up childhood memories from the days when I played in the local fields and woodland near my family home. Nobody seemed to know who owned that particular woodland, so all the local kids met there after school. We lit campfires, built tree houses, and made dams across the river that ran through the wood. I imagined that I was an adventurer in a faraway land, carving out a place in the wilderness. In an attempt to keep me and my brothers at home, my father built a primitive wooden house in an old tree in our garden. It was entered by a rope ladder that we could pull up through a trap door. Without knowing it, I was reenacting the type of lifestyle that my ancestors may have lived thousands of years ago. Living close to nature is no longer a necessity today, but more of a privilege. Centuries ago, it was the only option for most people as the growing human population scraped a living from the surface of the earth. But somewhere along the way, we have lost that vital connection with nature. No longer do most people in the Western world have to build their own shelters, grow their staple food, or catch their own dinner. This disconnect with the natural world has enormous implications for the protection of nature, but also for our personal happiness. Few modern children know the simple pleasures of climbing a tree, fishing in a stream, or picking a handful of wild berries. Increasingly, we experience the natural world remotely, if at all, through television, the internet, or through a car window. Children today would have to search quite hard to find a woodland near their home. The native forests that once covered the island were cut and cleared centuries ago, leaving a country dominated by agriculture. While the colonial power that ruled Ireland for over 800 years is widely blamed for deforesting the country, most of the native woodland was already gone by the medieval period. By the early 20th century, when Ireland achieved independence, there were just a few fragments of the old woodland remaining, a tiny fraction of which is classed as ancient woodland. And, as the new country geared up to the modern world, it chose to replace the natural vegetation with fast-growing forests comprising exotic conifer species imported from North America. For most people today, a walk in the woods means visiting lines of dense, coniferous plantation or watching these forests cleared like a field of corn. In the 21st century, Ireland's native woodland is in the emergency ward. A few of the remaining fragments are protected as nature reserves. Even there, uncontrolled deer populations are grazing out new seedlings and natural regeneration is rare. Invasive plants such as rhododendron and laurel infest many old estate woodlands, blocking out the light and leaving the ground beneath bare and lifeless. Of the 1,320 sites covered in the National Survey of Native Woodland, the majority were small or very small in extent, with half being 6 hectares or less, and only 3% of those surveyed being over 50 hectares. Traditional skills of woodland management, such as coppicing with standards, which can open dense canopies to let in the sunlight, have been largely forgotten. The patient is on life support and, unless radical treatment is administered, our grandchildren will not have a chance to experience the joy of the wild woods. Becoming the owner of this farm and woodland was a special privilege for me, but also a big responsibility. I had to learn to manage it properly. It all seemed a bit like a dream, but my voyage of discovery had begun. Exploring this small piece of countryside is exciting. Finding old trees, looking for good places to cross a stream, or just standing still to listen to the sounds in the wood is like experiencing childhood again. Simple pleasures for all the senses. I search for fallen nuts, collect sticks for the fire in winter, or shoulder a fallen log, just as Ned would have done, and carry it back along the track to the house. Everything in the world seems to be changing rapidly. Attitudes to the current climate breakdown are changing too, and there is a growing awareness that planting trees and restoration of permanent woodland cover are among the best ways to capture the excess carbon that we are daily releasing to the atmosphere. But woodlands offer so much more to our environment, to our health, and as a renewable resource to replace the fossil fuels that will soon be in short supply. Restoring Ireland's native woodland is just as important to me as safeguarding our traditional culture. Ned's farm and woodland are part of our heritage and should be passed on to future generations intact. But protection of this priceless asset will not happen by itself. It will take vision, commitment, and long-term management, such as that shown by some landowners in the past centuries, planted trees for their grandchildren and harvested timber that their grandparents had planted for them. The remaining native woods of Ireland are like fragments of a long-lost landscape. They are disappearing, and new native woodlands are not being added quickly enough to replace them. It is the equivalent of a decaying oak tree that is no longer producing seed. My ambition is to keep this one small patch of wildwood alive. In this land, I had found the practical project and the inspiration that I needed. It offered no material profit, but an opportunity to learn and to make a real difference to one small patch of wild nature. This book is the story of my journey of discovery about woodland here and in different parts of Ireland, where other people are striving to hold on to these fragments of our heritage. Ned had a vision for the future of his land, and it is our responsibility to make this happen. Winter. Sleeping trees. The oak trees were bare in the winter of 1860, when Ned's father, a previous tenant of our land, died suddenly in his late 30s, having contracted pneumonia during a bout of severe weather. Ned was still a young man when he took over the tenancy of the farm from his father.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.